вот уже треть жителей США в возрасте от 18 до 24 лет верят, что Земля плоская, а почти 15% американцев в возрасте за 30 с ними согласны.
Никому не нравится чувство, что мы находимся на маленьком шарике, который несется сквозь Вселенную. Да, закроют программы с астрофизическим и космическим уклоном. Оставшиеся естественные науки, как биология, геология, океанология, археология и другие, должны быть полностью обновлены.
The world's still round. I'm here to tell you it's not. It's flat!
he's an interesting guy, man, and you know, he believes it, so. Kyrie, the Earth is flat, right?
Yeah.
So, whatever.
Yeah, the Earth is flat. That's news.
That's news. Here we go.
We are TFR. TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Broadcasting straight to you from a large spaceship currently flashing its display lights blue. No, red. Wait, blue again. What in the world is even happening right now? Oh, right. It's just the strangest election in history. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Strange World, where the truth is often stranger than fiction. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, the creator of Flat Earth Clues, which proposed that all of us are living inside a Truman Show enclosed structure thousands of miles wide. Check it out at marksargent.com, enclosedworld.com, or just Google Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, that's because the entire internet is being jammed up by this stupid staged election, which I didn't even want to do a show tonight because most of you are going to be watching the election. But you know, because of you guys, you know, oh, Mark, you should do a show. Mark, you should do a show. Emails and calls. I have CNN, the website, and I'm sure I'll have other websites up in the background monitoring this for you, although I can almost guarantee. And that little thing, that blue, red, blue thing I said in the beginning, I wrote that this morning before I even decided to do anything. And I called this 2 months ago, asked my own family. I called this months ago. I said, look, it's going to come down. They're going to turn it into a horse race. They're going to turn it into a basketball game where it's 100 points apiece with 2 minutes to go. That's what they're going to turn into. This thing, if it gets decided tonight, it'll be a miracle. It'll be so close that there'll be, it's probably a state recount or two in some of the battleground states, and it's just going to be a mess. Not that any of this matters anyway, but we'll talk about that, I'm sure, with some of the callers. For those of you listening to this on YouTube and want to hear the show live as it happens, please go to Truth Frequency Radio for the latest schedule. Currently, this show is on Tuesday nights at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern. It is currently, and somebody's calling right now. It's currently November 8th, which means somebody's calling. So let's see if we can get them in. You are live with Strange World right now, November 8th. Sorry, yeah, November 8th. Are you there? Ah, they hung up. Whatever. Loser, call back. The quote of the day from the Peanut Gallery is, if voting made any difference, they wouldn't let us do it. That was from Mark Twain. Excellent. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That phone number again is 720-897-6111. Note that people that announce their election results on this station does not necessarily reflect the opinion of the station. So anyway, I might as well just get right to it before I get to the email. Let's do election results. What's happening right now as of 7 o'clock Pacific? That's 10 o'clock Eastern. It is too close to call. The Peanut Gallery says it's 147-122 Trump. First one to 270 electoral votes wins. Of course, that number will swap a little bit because Clinton will definitely get the entire West Coast. It's 150 to 122 Trump at the moment. But again, once California announces, that number will then flip and Hillary will be in the lead. And that's going to come down to the battleground states, and which will be like Ohio and Wisconsin and Minnesota and, of course, Florida and Alaska. But the big ones, the big electoral votes, remember, it's all based on population. Not that it matters anyway, but we'll talk about that later on. So currently, it's undecided. I knew it was going to be undecided. That's why I didn't want to do a show. But you know what? Because I like giving the people what they want, you guys get a show. So 720-897-6111. And I've got emails already queued up. So let's get to them, shall we? To Mark Sargent, thought it was worth mentioning that Genesis says the firmament is heaven. As some of us regard the dome as what's separating us from the heavens, we assume it is a dense liquid dome, which would make sensible the firmament dividing the waters. One could lead from that unto what might be underneath us, as is called hell generally. I have confidence the hollow earth theory fits, that underneath us is a cavernous fiery abyss, possibly layered or compartmentalized with icy portions, maybe even windy. Didn't sound so bad. Helping to pressure our system above, with a great deep below that which the pillars of earth would stand through. Heaven's a liquid realm, hell is a fiery gaseous realm, earth betwixt. That is literally the first time I've ever used that word, betwixt, B-E-T-W-I-X-T. I don't know what time in history you are calling from, or writing from, but this email was obviously sent from hundreds of years ago. And then to quote some passages from Genesis 1:6, and God said, let there be firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. 1:7, and God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. 1:8, and God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. May blessings go your way, Mark. Yahweh be with you. From Philip McKenzie, currently in Toledo, Ohio. And yes, I will be starting up the Church of Mark shortly after this, so be prepared. Next email is called Shockwave. Sent by, and this one's interesting, unindoctrinated beings. And there's a lot of hyphens there. That's why I spread that out. Hey, Mark, appreciate your work. I was listening to your last Q&A about Mary that is printing flyers and putting them all over. I think it would be good for someone as yourself that's able to reach a large audience to get as many people as possible from all states in America and multiple other countries to make a lot of cards and flyers, etc., and pass them out within a time frame organized from you. If you're not a troll, let's shock the world. Oh, this is why I've got to preview these emails. But you know what? I don't have time. If you're not a troll. No, I'm not a troll. Wait, how would I even be a troll? Make the world start asking what's happening. Thanks for reading. Awesome. 714 area code. Let's see if we can pick them up. You are on live with Strange World on November 8th, election night. What's going on?
Hey, Mark, what's up? It's Raul again here from California.
Hey, you guys haven't chimed in yet. When do the polls close where you are?
Oh, geez. Well, voting here ends at 8 o'clock.
Got it. So in at least another hour.
So,
and then
yeah,
I mean
yeah,
it's going Democrats. So what I was just saying before you came on mm-hmm. is that once California, you know, signs over their stuff to blue, then it'll tip in Hillary's favor for a little while, and it doesn't really matter. This thing's not ending tonight. I almost guarantee it.
No, it's not going to end.
It's not going to end.
They got to make everybody happy.
Yeah, it's going to go till tomorrow, and the big states, you know, and the biggest states will be the ones that'll demand. And in fact, if it's so close that it comes down to like one state, then whoever's the loser is going to demand a recount, like it's Ohio or Florida. I mean, geez, here we go. Deja vu.
Always comes down to Florida.
Yeah, here we go with Florida mm-hmm. again. Even though the Bushes have nothing to do with Florida at the time being. So
exactly.
Anyway, what's
up? So I have a little theory on this.
Yeah, what?
So I was talking to my buddy about this, actually a few buddies, before even election day. And, you know, a lot of radio stations have been pushing the whole go out and vote, go out and vote. It doesn't matter who you vote for, just go out and vote. And I always thought that was kind of weird. You know, why, you know, I know some radio stations are Democratic, some are Republican, but everybody's idea is just go out and vote. That's the message out there. You see it on TV. You hear it on the radio.
Yeah.
It's just media driven. And today just hit me. I'm thinking the main reason they want us to go out and vote, too, is, and I wanted to ask your thought on this.
Yeah.
It's just a big census. Just a big census for
yeah.
free. They don't have to send anybody out. We're going out there. We're letting you know what's going on.
Yeah. No, not only that.
What are your thoughts on that?
We're standing in line. Yeah, it's not only are we going up for free, is it free? We're actually standing in line. It costs, there's man hours being spent on this thing. It's, and again, it's the Kang-Kodos argument anyway. And since I've got you, I will rattle this off mm-hmm. to you if you guys know, no one's ever heard this before.
Yeah.
And that is, look, I'm not going to try to burst anyone's bubble. I try to stay positive whenever possible, and I'm not going to just come flat out and say I'm not going to flat earth out say that your vote doesn't count and you shouldn't be voting at all. I'm not going to say that.
No, you know, you're pretty good about all that stuff. I commend you on that.
Thanks.
Really good about that.
But there's a big but here. But you got a problem, and that is it all comes down to money. Which is, if I have, I'm just going to give you a little rundown example. And that is, if I'm a billionaire,
sure.
right? If I'm a billionaire, and the question I ask people is, say I'm a billionaire, who do I donate? What party do I donate to? The Republican or the Democrat? People are going, well, you know, if you want this and this and this, or you're pro-war, or you're pro-this, you're gonna go Republican. And if you're, you know, if you're more liberal, blah, 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 you're going to go Democrat. And I go, wrong. I am going to pay both of them. I'm going to give them both the same check. It's going to be a big check because if I donate, let's say $1 million to each party, because they don't mm-hmm. care. They're not going to yeah. look at me. It's like, well, you donated $1 million to the other team. They're not going to care. All they care about is the contribution check. But here's, and you're thinking, what's your point? My point is for $1 million, not only do I get to have my picture taken with whoever wins, but I mm-hmm. also get to potentially, you know, sit in on a meeting or two and, you know, maybe, you know, help influence, rub elbows. And if I donate enough money, then I can actually help influence policy. And so what's my point? My point is it took me millions of dollars to do that. The average person's vote doesn't make a damn bit of difference. But the illusion of choice, and that, and if anyone doesn't know what I'm talking about, look up the Simpsons episode, mm-hmm. Kang and Kodos. Where I believe it was Clinton was Kang and Bob Dole was Kodos. Didn't matter who you voted for because they were both aliens. And that's and it was symbolic for what was going on there, which was it doesn't matter who you vote for because they're both paid for from, you know, they're both bought and paid for. The the rule of power, the first rule of power, and I can't repeat this enough, is never – well, I'll give you the longer version. Never put yourself in a position to be overthrown, which means the ones that are really in power aren't the people that are in front of the camera. You know, Obama's not the most powerful man in the world. Everybody should know that. But you can still blame Obama and unemployment. It's like you forget. It's like, really? Do you think he's the smartest economic guy? You think he's the smartest scientist? Do you think he's the smartest? No, he's just a front man for a band. That's all he is.
Exactly.
It's the producer. Anyway, sorry. That's my opening.
Exactly. And I totally agree. It always boils down to this. I tell buddies this too, when it comes down to Democrats and Republicans. It's kind of like the whole lawyer theory. When you go to court and you have a lawyer representing you, you know, there's a good chance that they might know the lawyers across the way and they're buddies.
Yeah.
You know, they might be in court fighting two different cases or whatnot, or the same case, and at the end of the night they're gonna have a drink together, you know, so they all know each other.
Oh yeah, that's an excellent point. You're absolutely right. That's a fairly good analogy. That when it's all said and done, which is why, and I don't want to quote too many biblical things, that there's there's an old saying that is God hates lawyers, and it's like, why, where did that come from? And that's because, and it was something I remembered since I was a kid. God hates lawyers because the lawyers don't have any personal stake in it. So if your guy is going to be sentenced for, I don't know, 30 years, the lawyer, nothing happens to the lawyer. Now, if the lawyer there, it's like you say, well, 10% of, you know, let's say I'm not even saying the lawyer would do jail time, but let's say for every year your guy gets sentenced, you're out of pocket $1,000, right? Lawyers would spend a lot more time. You know, if they had a personal stake in it, the lawyers, you know, they cut deals. We've seen movies and television shows about this. They cut deals just to keep the system going. And I don't want to get into it. The lawyers are a whole other thing. You know, the old saying, no offense to any lawyers listening. I doubt if there are, but the, what do you call, 1,000 dead lawyers at the bottom of the ocean? Good start. Yeah.
Right. A good start.
So, anyway.
Last thing, man.
What else you got?
Yeah, go ahead. Have a question?
Nope. Go.
Yeah. So here's my theory on the whole election. I haven't voted for a while, and you know, I have a buddy who's really, you know, pro Republican, and he really gets into the whole election. And I just tell him, hey man, that's your soap opera, you know. And, you know, I broke it down to him, so I gave him my theory, what was going to go down. I really think Hillary Clinton's going to win no matter what. And I was really surprised to look at the early votes and Trump, you know, way ahead.
Yeah.
But she's slowly closing in. And so I was looking at it as, you know, they're going to make the Republican voters happy. They're going to want them to think they have a chance, you know, to win.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying this is for sure. That's just my, you know, I'm taking a guess at it. And I've always thought Hillary was already picked from the get-go, you know, the first woman president, yada, yada. I didn't think Trump had a chance to win, but I think they're making it seem like he does have a chance. And then with the votes, the early votes coming in, he was just knocking her out.
Okay.
I think what might happen is, again, to your point, it's going to be a run to the finish. It's going to be a hairline. And I think she's going to win, man. That's what I think.
You know, you may be right.
You know,
you may be right. It's very, very possible. I mean, again, I can't call it at this point because either like some of the people were saying, the commentators, they're like, look, this is the first presidential race where both candidates have a serious approval rating before they even go into office. And, you know, it's really I've talked about this for the last year, which is, who do you hate least? You know, who is the lesser of two evils?
Yeah.
And it's a statement that, I mean, I'm embarrassed, you know, not to the point of changing citizenship, but I'm embarrassed to the point of it's like, look, you know, of being an American at some point. It's like, look, what, look at our choices here. We've got the jilted wife of an ex-president and a reality television star. Those are our choices for president. It's like, really? There's nobody else that could actually, you actually bring him to the spotlight. Nobody else was willing. You sabotaged everybody else. What happened to Chris Christie? What happened to Rubio? What happened to all these other guys that supposedly
politicians? Yeah.
But it should surprise me. No, it shouldn't, because reality television has taken over so many things. And so why not have a reality television star? He's not even the biggest reality star.
You should have seen my coworker, man. You know, she was just having a meltdown. We had the TV on here at work, and right when it showed Trump was ahead by so much, she said, I'm getting sick, my stomach's hurting. And I'm thinking, oh, man, she's getting way into it, you know.
Yeah.
And I said, hey, you know what? You never know. Hillary has a chance. You know, she might come from behind. Maybe they want us to think that Trump actually does have a chance. And they want to keep everybody happy. Yeah. You know, they want to make it a close race. But anyhow, that was
well,
my
I'll, I'll be announcing the results at every break, you know, for the time that I'm on tonight. But I'm willing to bet almost the freaking farm that it is not being settled tonight. We are
going to
be.
So you think it's going to overtime?
Oh yeah, yeah. It'll be tomorrow morning, and then even then it'll be contested because again, you know, you're gonna if it comes down to one state, neither side's going to give in on this one. Anyway, I hate to do this to you, man, but I got a bunch of other things I gotta rip through. But thank you.
No problem, man. Keep up the good work.
Thanks very much, and thanks for listening on election night.
All right, anytime, man.
All right, have a good one.
God bless.
See ya. Bye. Bye-bye. All right, guys. Phone number to call in. Here's another one. 306 area code. Wonder who it's going to be. You are on live with Strange World on election night.
Hey, Mark, it's Clint from Canada again. How you doing?
Hey, someone's calling in. It doesn't really have a stake in the game. Right on.
Well, I just started listening. I don't know if we're able to talk about flat Earth or is this election.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No. You can talk about, hey, look, if you want to talk about flat Earth, awesome. I'd love to get at least a question or two that isn't going to be about the election because I'm just sitting here refreshing the page trying to see where we stand, how much blue and how much red is going on. So what's happening up in Canada?
I don't know. I think Canadians are about as anxious to get this election stuff over with as probably the Americans are. But, for the record, I think Hillary's going to get in, not like I wanted to. But of the two lesser evils, I'm probably going to, if I had money to bet, it probably would be Hillary. Because she's in more with the Bilderbergers, trilateralists, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
And if anyone's going to get in, but my prediction is I think there's going to be an event. And probably Obama might continue for a while. I don't know,
Here's let me throw a scenario for you, see if you agree. Because let's say Hillary wins, right? Mm-hmm. But let's say Hillary dies or gets a stroke or something. I know I'm not going to be super grim. I'm not the grim, for God's sakes. But let's say Hillary gets a stroke, you know, because she's had some health issues recently. Everybody's seen it, you know, either that or she's a fine actress. But let's say she has a stroke. What happens? Does her VP take over? You know, there's a lot of people in America don't even know who her VP is. And then who's his VP? Yeah. Or does Obama then step in and say, I mean, that's the smallest of the events. Of course, you could go a lot bigger. Mm-hmm. You know, that wonderful alien movie, it's coming out on the 11th, The Arrival. I'd love to have that tied in with something. Or the Donald Sutherland television series, which has been raising a few eyebrows, called The Designated Survivor, which is... That all sorts of a big assassination attempts and a whole bunch of politicians die. And like the Department of the Interior lead is the guy that Kiefer. What did I say? Peanut Gallery? I said Kiefer.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say Kiefer Sutherland. Yeah, Kiefer Sutherland, not Donald.
Donald? Oh, crap. Donald's his dad. Yeah, sorry about that.
Okay.
I totally forgot that. But what's interesting is Secretary of State. I believe it's John Kerry. Where did he leave yesterday? You know, he should be in the States for the election, right? Secretary of State. Do you know where he is right now?
Antarctica.
What's he doing there? You couldn't get further away than Antarctica. Yeah. I mean,
what the hell's in Antarctica that would be more important than this?
He'd be like right there in the thick of things, you know, drinking and partying with all these guys. You'd think. But
the Hillary fainting thing. I know that I saw that video, like you did probably, where she gets out of the thing.
Yep.
She gets out of the SUV, had her back to us. I don't even know if it was really her. Seed planting. If it's okay, they're setting the stage for something. I don't know.
I agree with you, man. And I think it is some fine theater they have produced here. Who would have ever thought that two hated candidates would be neck and neck? Go, you know, it's 10 o'clock Eastern time right now, 10:20 Eastern time. And we aren't even remotely close to solving this thing. Not even.
So when you have electronic voting, it's pretty easy to predict who they want to win, I think, right?
So why is it, I'm looking at all the battleground states right now, and nobody is willing to call it. Nobody wants to go out on a limb. And you'd think some of these networks, kind of like Fox News did back in the day, you know, when they predicted Florida. You'd think somebody would step in and say, oh, yeah, I'll hear it. But nope, nobody's going to take it. I mean, there's a huge chunk of red in the middle. There's blue on the East Coast. And now we're waiting for there'll be blue on the West Coast. And, you know, you're just looking for the battleground states. Anyway.
Well, it's going to be interesting waking up tomorrow morning and flipping on the news to find out, okay, what has happened overnight? you know, with the election. And so, like, I don't know, God, who knows? Like I say, it's a movie, just waiting to see the ending and what it is. But I had a flat earth question that's been.
Oh, yeah. What do you got? What do you got? What do you got?
Okay. Nikola Tesla.
Yep.
I haven't studied the guy in depth, but I have never ever heard anyone talk about, reveal, or show where he's talked about the earth is flat. If anyone would know the earth is flat, it would be him. But has he?
He was quoted as saying that the earth was, oh crap, and I don't have the quote in front of me, but he was quoted as saying that the earth wasn't necessarily a sphere. It was a realm. I think that's what he said. Okay. He didn't say it was flat, but he said it was a realm. And I thought, well,
I remember hearing something about that too. I remember hearing something about, but as outspoken as that guy was about, you know, AC, DC current and all that stuff, and all that stuff, that guy was very outspoken. Would you have not thought that he would just say, hey, people, we're living on a flat earth?
But he wasn't a legend like he is now. So okay. if back then, you know, maybe peer pressure. Yeah, he was outspoken. And yeah, he made some weird stuff. But at the same time, you know, he still had to rely on funding for things. You know, he wasn't independently wealthy. Now, if he was independently wealthy, yes, he might actually say it. And then he'd turn into like a Howard Hughes thing. But I think he still didn't want to sound like a, and Peanut Gallery just wrote in on this. Nikola Tesla, Earth was a realm. It is not a planet. It is not an object. Therefore, it has no edge. Earth would be more easily defined as a system environment. Earth is also a machine. It is a Tesla coil. That's pretty much says it all for Nikola. Now, did he say it was absolutely flat? No, but, you know, he probably had some great insights. I mean, if the guy built even a quarter of the stuff that he built, he probably knew. Go ahead.
Well, no, I'm sorry. I'm just listening, but I'm just thinking as much as he believed in an idea, you think he would have just kept expanding on this, and this would have been a huge thing for him. I'm sure he came across it, but I just thought if anyone in the past, you know, 100 years would have expounded on stuff, it would have been Tesla with Earth. And I'm a flat earther. I don't have a problem admitting that. But I thought Tesla would have gone on about this more and more.
I'll throw one more thing in there. And again, I think he was dodging the issue as far as, because if anyone said the Earth was flat, even when Tesla was around, he probably wouldn't be taken as seriously. He also wrote, again, thanks to the Peanut Gallery for this, the sun and the moon are powered wirelessly with the electromagnetic field, otherwise known as the ether. This field also suspends the celestial spheres and electromagnetic levitation. Electromagnetic levitation disproves gravity because the only force you need to counter is the electromagnetic force, not gravity. The stars are attached to the firmament. So he's dropping hints all over the place. And he goes along with what I always thought, which was, because people are saying, well, what's gravity? And I said, it's electromagnetic. It has to be. Because, but it's a molecular magnet. You know, it's not a standard, you know, neodymium, whatever those, you know, those super strong magnets.
Yeah.
This is a molecular magnet that can even attract organics. Because if you have something that can attract organics, and you have it underneath a surface, what's the difference? What can you do? What can you say that gravity does that you can't do with a molecular magnet? We do the same thing with software now. Only it's just numbers. So anyway, what else you got?
Two other things quickly. Northern Lights, what the hell are they? Where do they come from?
Got me, man. They're pretty and they're part of the system.
see them up here in Canada.
Oh, yeah, yeah, no.
Are you also in Vancouver? I mean, I meant to ask you too. Are you Canadian?
No. But I have.
Are you just escaping to Vancouver?
No, Victoria, if you've ever been.
Victoria, sorry, yeah.
I'm not in Victoria at the moment, but probably will be there again soon. Oh, crap. We're going to break. Oh, man. I'm sorry. You got to go.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay, next time, though. Okay.
You.
All right.
Okay. Thanks, right. Mark.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.
No hate. No hype. No fear.
You're listening to Truth Frequency Radio.
We are TFR.
Welcome back to Strange World. It is November 8th, 2016, which means election night in the United States. And normally I wouldn't do an election show because everyone would be glued to their sets. But as promised, I am going to give you the score on the half hour and the top of the hour. So the score right now, because they're going to treat this like a sporting event, and it's kind of like a basketball score right now, it's 168 to 131 Donald Trump with at least 5 minutes to go in regulation. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. And for those of you who don't know anything about election results, the first one to 270 wins. So there's still a little ways to go. And again, this thing is not going to be settled tonight. So please feel free to call in and talk about the election. You can talk about Flat Earth. Talk about whatever you want. In the meantime, I am going to be reading some emails like this one. This one's from Michael. Saved by the Bell by a 425 area code. I wonder who it is. You're on live right now with Strange World.
Hey there, Mark, my fellow Washingtonian.
Hey!
It's Elizabeth. I might have some background noise. I'm going to pull over here.
All right. Just make sure you talk loud.
So I saw an interesting video which just came out within the last few days, and I forget who did it, but it's about the ISS.
Okay.
And he's showing, you know, how you don't see the space junk and you don't see any satellites and all this stuff.
Yep.
And he mentions that you don't see any airplanes. That is pretty genius.
Because the airplanes have aluminum bodies and they're really, really shiny when the sun shines on them.
Yeah.
And at night, you would see little streaks of light, especially in time lapse.
Yeah, so that is pretty genius right
there.
That's
pretty good. I hadn't thought of that. You're absolutely right. There are, at any given time, if you believe Plane Finder or Flight Tracker, there's at least, and by the way, 989 area code, call back, because I'm on a call right now. We're not doing any of that party line stuff. At any given time, there's 7,000 flights in the air, something that effect, you know, worldwide. So, yeah, the skies, especially in the northern hemisphere, should be crawling with jets.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Should be crawling
with
them.
That was very smart, that video. Then
it's
the
good.
Other thing,
yeah.
Before I go into it, just, I'm not trying to trick you, but just what is the size of the moon in relation to the Earth?
What I think the size of the moon is? I think, you mean
what's
what?
What the official is.
Oh,
and I don't know, but it's
Setup. Peanut Gallery is going to have to look it up for me. It's several thousand miles wide, though. If the Earth is 8,000 miles across, then I think the moon is between 1 and 2. I think it's supposedly, it's pretty big. Why? In fact, it's one of the biggest moon. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, it's the biggest moon in relation to the main body of anything in our solar system. It is, yeah, it was 1,000 miles, about 1,000, just under 1,100 miles. Okay, why?
Okay, so that's like 1/8 the size of the Earth. Okay, so someone asked you on the email show you just did about, oh, if you were making a video game, would you put in the curve? And
yeah.
On that same video, somebody linked to, oh, this is supposed to be this live footage from Japan showing you the moon's surface. There is so much curvature, it's not even funny. So if you think, okay, if the Earth is 8 times bigger, 7 times bigger,
yeah,
then you would just go 7 times farther before you would see the curve. So just from an airplane flying, taking pictures of the ground, you would see the curve just like on the moon. It's so silly.
Yeah, agreed.
Except that moon isn't really real, whatever they showed. But the point of it is showing that curve that's so obvious.
Yeah.
And yet, where is it on our thing?
Yeah, excellent.
Okay, then you were just talking about the Tesla.
Tesla, yes.
This is exactly what Michael Tellinger is saying, and I don't know where to look it up, but it's like toroidal fields coming together, and the center where they come together somehow is what's creating the Earth's surface.
Mm.
And that fits into exactly what you just read, the quote of Tesla.
Yeah.
And I don't have any links or anything to it, but this other guy talked about something similar, this thing called, what was it? The
That's all right. That's all right. But Tellinger is the new hotness right now. It's T-E-L-L-I-N.
He's just excited. He's posting all these things on his Facebook.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad. There's several people, including you, if I'm not mistaken, sent me things on him and said, yeah, I'm just so glad that he's joining forces. So
that's why I wanted to be the first when I saw his live presentation. But yeah, now he's posting all these things.
Yeah.
And I'm sure he will do a presentation that people can link to and stuff.
But he's
getting so much hate too.
Anybody with a big following, unfortunately, again, I got a name drop. That's why Alex Jones Show hasn't done anything on it yet, is because they said straight up that they were afraid that people would just, you know, the existing subscribers would turn them off. And I should really throw at him the Rob Skiba example. Rob Skiba had the same sort of thing going, and he took the chance, and he said, yeah, he lost some people, but he gained more than he lost. You know, he saw the trend, and it's like, you know, he just swapped out some people for another, for a larger group. And I wish more people would take that chance, because everybody that I've interviewed with, everybody any big players have gone in, you get those people. In fact, one of my early interviews, and I can't remember who it was with, the chat things were lighting up on his board, and they were saying, if you don't hang up on this guy or get him off the line, like right now, you know, I'm going to unsubscribe. You know, that's the sort of stuff. That's the fear once you get to a certain subscription level for a lot of people. So,
right.
Anyway.
They're making money.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's where I just see this video in my mind that I clicked on earlier today of supposedly showing the Earth, the moon's surface, and just so much curvature. And it's like, okay, whatever the proportion of the moon to the Earth, it should be the same.
Yeah, yeah. The curvature, well, yeah. If any sphere, if it's only 8 times smaller, then yeah, the curvature will be, you know, more exaggerated. But, you know, even on the ground, well, let's put it this way. None of the moon shots, you know, none of the astronaut shots, if I'm mistaken, showed, at least on ground level, showed any curve, which was interesting. So, anyway.
And one other thing that's semi-related.
Yeah.
Who's the guy, Jay Widener, that made the Kubrick's Odyssey and talked about the moon and all that? So he's going to be coming out with part 3 of that.
He hates flat Earth, by the way. And mostly because, you know, who he's a friend of. Oh crap, I forgot the guy's name. The guy who's supposed to debate that thinks there's bases on the moon.
The Nolan guy. Not Nolan.
No. Oh man, I can't believe I forgot his name. I was supposed to do a debate with him, Richard Hoagland. He's friends with Richard Hoagland. In fact, I think he and Richard collaborated on some crap. So yeah, he's going to hate. He is absolutely going to hate flat Earth because it ruins some of his work, and nobody wants to do that. You know, everyone tries to protect their own interests. It's like, man, get over it. If there's a new paradigm, just, you know, wipe off what you can't use and keep trudging on with the rest. But
we're done.
What, are you kidding? We're going all night. This show, we're going to tack on an extra 2 hours to this show. No, that's not true. I am absolutely going to go. Well, I know full well that there's going to be more car wrecks tomorrow morning, because if they even bother to try to do it in the morning, because this thing is not going to be decided at least until the morning commute. It's just not. So anyway,
whichever way it goes, you have half the population angry.
I know. It's the perfect setup for something
not good.
I know.
Yeah, it just creates all this anger.
I agree. Anyway, hey, I've got some more emails I got to read and stuff. So, okay. But thank you. Thank you very much. And you have a good night. And I am sure I will talk or hear from you soon.
Yes. And now I can't listen to this show. Whenever I call in, I can't listen to it. So.
Oh, because you're on it?
Yeah, but I could get the time after.
All right. You get used to your own voice, believe it or not, after a while. I hate my voice sometimes. I think I sound like
embarrassing
this.
And there's other people listening, so.
Oh, all right. All right. Anyway, you have a good one, okay?
All right, carry on.
All right, see ya.
Okay, bye.
Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That's 720-897. Boy, we're just going to get calls all night, aren't we? This one's from 989. You are on Live with Strange World. It's election night. And by the way, 845 area code, please wait, because I got to take this one. Are you on with me right now, by the way?
Yes, I am. My name's Don. I'm out in Skidway Lake, Michigan.
Right on, man. You're one of the battleground states right now, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yes, I am. I think it's going to go Michigan. I'll be honest, I don't go anywhere. I don't see a Trump sign. I haven't seen a Hillary sign anywhere, so it's kind of crazy that she'd get any votes at all.
Interesting. Yeah, I would imagine you guys are probably going to put in your ballots probably by either late tonight or tomorrow.
Yeah, hopefully it's for Donald Trump. I really don't care for both of them that much. But
nobody does. Nobody does.
I'd say Hillary's more in tune with what's going on with the big deception.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. So what else? Say anything else going on? Did you have any?
Oh yeah, I got a just a laundry list of stuff on my mind.
Do it. Here. Well, okay, you got like nine minutes. So what? Go.
Okay, I'll be quick. First thing I wanted to talk to you about is if you've seen the star and water, they're doing in science.
Soul luminescence. Yes.
Yeah, isn't that awesome? I didn't know.
That is awesome.
Run across that, and it makes up a lot of sense if you think that there's water over top of us.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I totally believe it. Somebody look that up. If you get a chance, if you don't know what we're talking about, we won't go into a great detail, but look up, I think it's called soul luminescence, right?
That's right. It's with radio frequencies they're using. Yep. And then it's actually fusion, which is creating the light.
That is freaky stuff. I mean, especially when you slow it down in super slow-mo, I mean, it looks like a real star. And then you got to wonder, are stars and how big do stars actually have to be if you are generating that from a tiny little droplet?
Bingo. Yeah. Exactly.
All right. What else? What else?
I got another thing here. I live on a lake here up in Michigan.
Really? Shocker.
Lakes a lot. Yeah. I mean, there's lakes everywhere here. But one of the things I wanted to talk about was curvature of water.
Yep.
Where there is none. I live on a lake. It's probably a mile around. And it's absolutely flat.
Yep.
There has to be a test that shows at what point does a lake go from being completely flat to actually having some curvature. You would think if the earth was curved that there would have to be a point like this lake is 3 miles. It's curved where the lake I live on, it's almost a mile.
Yep.
Absolutely no curve on it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's easier to tell because it's a sliding, you know, sliding scale is the wrong word, because it exaggerates it's 8 inches per mile squared, so it gets more exaggerated as you go further, which is why, like, the Lake Michigan test with Chicago is so great, because you have 50 miles to play with. Of course, how many times do you see Lake Michigan get perfectly glass-like? That's the suck part of that. You know, it's so big, it's never, like, glass, as far as I can tell, unless it's frozen.
Yeah, but there is another lake by me, which is funny that you mentioned lakes that get like glass. Well, here in Michigan, guess what? The lakes freeze over in the wintertime.
Yes.
And what I was thinking is doing a laser keyhole test. And what I mean by is if you took a laser as it goes further, obviously the laser spreads out. You can't tell
You get
where
a couple
it is exactly
feet,
by measuring.
Yeah, a couple feet dispersion per mile. That's what Jaronism was showing.
Now, what if you took that laser and shined it into a lens that return that laser back into a laser point, say, every mile?
Sorry, my ride's coming by. Hang on. All right. It's possible. I don't know. I don't know the tech to actually do that.
Well, if you use, don't they have a way that you can tell your altitude?
Refocus the laser?
Exactly. You're refocusing the laser every mile. So wouldn't it miss after a few miles? If you refocus, shouldn't it miss?
The thing is, I don't even know.
After 1 mile or half a mile?
If you're thinking about doing this over ice, I don't even think you need a laser, to be honest. Because as long as you get the camera low enough to the ground, because I was actually thinking you should be able to do this with just a car headlights. You know, something bright. You don't even have to go out and buy a spotlight or anything. Just get some car headlights on high beams, because a car headlights is only about 3 feet off the ground. And then, you know, and then see how far, because I remember somebody proposing to me that last year that you go to like the salt flats, you know, where it's not ice.
Exactly.
Well, ice would be better because then you don't get the heat waves. And you take a car 10 miles away, have them turn on its headlights and sit with a camera at, you know, in the prone position, lie down on the ground and see if you can see the headlights. And at 10 miles and or whatever the lake is. But you're right. Ice would be better because
sometimes the ice freezes like the beginning. When it first freezes, it's only a quarter of an inch, but it froze solid for 5 miles. You go to this lake by us called Holton Lake, you could get an amazing cast on a clear day. And
that's
then I had a couple other things I wanted to mention. One was where I'm at in Michigan right now, moon in relation to the sun. When you look up into the sky in the day right now in Michigan, you can see the sun and the moon in the same sky. That shouldn't be possible if, because it seems like it's possible because you're looking in the same sky, and most people think, well, look, the sun is just shining across the sky over to the moon. But in relation, the moon is right there, and the sun is 92 million miles away. It should be shining the backside of the moon, shouldn't it?
Mm, good point. Good point. Maybe. It, you know, other, like, people are listening. The only problem with questions like that is three-dimensional modeling in your head can get a little tricky. But you might be right. You might be onto something. There's been several people that have done videos on it. My perspective is one of the best ones. And I like all the thoughts that are going on there. But do I think it's the silver bullet? Is it the lowest common denominator thing that everyone would understand? No. But it's a good point. It's a good point. I like it.
And then the last thing I had was a helium balloon in space. Now, yes. If you filled the balloon full of helium on the space station, which way does it go? And Earth, helium rises because air is obviously heavier than helium.
Yes.
Minus the gravity. So what happens to a helium balloon on the space station? Which way does it go? Does it go nowhere? Does it stay right in the middle? It doesn't. It makes no sense to me. There's no up. There's no down. There's no gravity. So what does a helium balloon, and there is no test.
That's a good thing. Someone should Google that. What does a helium balloon do in zero gravity? Which that's a good one. No one's ever asked that. That's awesome.
And then my last thing was just a common thing I'm sure you've heard many times, which I've been trying to think in my mind, is matter in space. There's no matter in space. So if you had any sort of propellant trying to propel you in space, it's not an equal reaction because The only action happening is the propellant acting away from the thing, but it's not hitting any matter. So
yep, you're absolutely right.
How could you actually travel anywhere in space if there's no matter there to push against in the first place?
Yep, and that's an easier
go anywhere.
That's an easier one for people to understand because, like rubber, where rubber meets the road, rubber pushes off the concrete below it.
Exactly.
A propeller on a boat pushes off the water. Even a jet airplane, which is just a really fast moving propeller, series of propellers, push against the air. You know, when we're swimming through water, we are kicking against something. So when you're in space, what exactly is the vehicle pushing off against?
And this is the thing that got me is, say you got going, you projected yourself off, and you went around the moon and you did all this, but how did you slow down on the way back?
Yeah.
Without pushing it against anything, and you're going all these thousands of miles an hour. To me, it seems unfathomable to slow down. I know when I'm in a car going 30, if I hit the brakes, it damn near throws me, through the windshield. So
excellent.
How do you slow down from these high speeds and it be survivable?
Excellent points. Seriously, I'm gonna throw that in with my if I ever get to meet Neil deGrasse Tyson, throw that in with my what shielding
exactly.
did you use for the Van Allen belts, which no one will still talk about. No one will ever talk about it. So what shielding did you use? You had to use one of the common metals, lead or gold. What'd you use? And they didn't.
Exactly.
Nobody ever just trails off. They won't say it because they didn't have anything because they never went. Anyway.
Hey, it was real awesome talking to you, man. I hope I didn't use up too much.
No, you're good.
I never get to catch you live.
I'm glad that you caught me with some non-election questions because this election is going to drive me nuts. I am definitely not going to stay up till 1 a.m. watching this damn thing. Although I will announce before you go that Trump took Ohio. Which is, puts him in a sizable lead, but it doesn't matter because the entire West Coast is going to go Clinton, so it'll be tied up again. It's the old joke about basketball, and that is professional basketball, and that is why don't we just skip the middleman and set the score to 100 each, and then set the clock to 2 minutes and let them go because that's what it always ends up being, in the big games. Anyway,
yeah, it seems like he's going to win 35 states and. She's going to win 15 and win the whole thing.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. Anyway, man, thanks very much. You have a good night. And
great talking with you.
Yeah, have a good one.
Yes, sir.
All right. All right, I got a few minutes to the break. His number is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. And this is election night. It is November 8th, 2016. So if you are listening to this and it's not a Tuesday night, then you're not listening to it live. So don't call the phone number. Because even though it'll ring, it'll just go to voicemail. But I will pick up live if you call now. Email. Let's get one in. This one's from Michael. Hi, not the norm for me, but here's a little about myself. I'm a United States Army veteran. I served as a forward observer. I have over 9 years in target acquisition, land navigation, digital and analog, map reading, and radio communication. Only this past few weeks have I become a flat earther. Yet, I was one who always knew something wasn't right with the world and everything about it. Done to the education that was shoved down our throats every year, my realization didn't come like most. I have a younger brother who we have talked before about flat earth, yet I brushed it aside. I am now currently an independent contractor for a company that I drive trucks for, and I see almost all this nation weekly. Last month, I was driving on Interstate 90, heading northbound through New York, just south of Buffalo, the very beginning where you can see the Great Lakes. On this day, it was a beautiful, bright, and clear. I looked out and saw sewing that I shouldn't be able to something. Spell checker. That I shouldn't be able to see over the other side of the lake. It was Port Rowan, Canada, CA, almost 60 miles away, and I could see the whole shore, and I kept watching. Now, I was driving you, and I almost wrecked seeing what I saw. It hit me like a ton of bricks. And it didn't take me more than a few minutes to understand why. Ever since then, it's been a chase. Yet, I have hit a brick wall. I have been deep in the rabbit hole ever since then. It has let me see what I turned a blind eye to, all that I really knew about the world. I found your video, and I have been playing catch-up ever since then. I would love to chat. He didn't sign his name, but his name is Michael. I think it's Binkerhoff. So thank you, Michael, for writing the email. Yeah, write me another email sometime. And after you use spell checker, read your email again, because your spell checker, you're saying yes to everything spell checker has. And some of those words I had to correct for you. I was trying to do it on the fly, but that's the sort of talent I have. Okay, this one's from Greg. Mark, I hope you are well. Your Flat Earth store. Oh, yeah, that's right. I got this. I got a neat little, tiny little model. It's kind of like a paperweight of the Flat Earth. Your Flat Earth.store product is on its way to you. Shipping from Australia is about 2 weeks, so it should arrive soon. It actually got here sooner than 2 weeks. Also, I've made some slideshow images for Flat Earth awareness videos in YouTube widescreen 16:9 format. They are on my server at the unlisted link below and only available to yourself and Zen Garcia. They are free to use in your videos. I haven't clicked on this yet, so hopefully they're still there. In your videos with no obligation, and they do not identify with the Flat Earth store. I hope you can find them useful. Best wishes, GP Gardner. And he is from, because I've got his package right here, he is from Currumbin, C-U-R-R-U-M-B-I-N, Queensland, I believe. I believe the abbreviation is QLD, and that's in Australia. 4223. They only have 4 zip code numbers because, I don't know, they're Australian. Anyway, thank you. Thank you very much for that. I did get it, and I'm going to show it off on any video I get a chance to, because it's really, really cool. I love little things like that because it's pocket size. So, anyway. Let's move on to Eddie. Eddie writes, Russian made night vision for $600. Hey, Mark, I've listened to many of your shows on YouTube. I live in Japan and remember you mentioning about a Russian-made night vision for around $600. Could you please give me the name and make of where I can find it? I live in Japan, but I have friends in the United States who can purchase it for me and send it to me. You think so? I don't think you're supposed to mail it to you because it's night vision. It's considered military equipment, but that's neither here nor there. Bend the rules a bit. I just want something nice to look at the sky at night and figure out what's going on up there. Ha ha. If possible, reply to this email, and I'm afraid I may miss you saying it again, as I have 2 daughters and sometimes I get distracted when they talk to me. All the best. Eddie Alencar, a Brazilian living in Japan. He says in parentheses, and yes, it's not $600. I think it's like 400 and change American. And that is, you can go on Amazon. The ones that I liked the best out of any of them were called Night Owl. They're Night Owl brand. And they are 5X. You want to get 5 power. Don't get the 3 power. 5 power is about as much as you can get for generation 1. There's like Gen 1 and Gen 2 and Gen 3 night vision. You don't need Gen 3 night vision for looking up at the sky. These things are way too far away. Gen 3 is for if you're trying to figure out if you need to shoot the guy that's coming and he's 20 feet away from you and you need to tell who he is. That's super clear. and they cost you a ton of money. Gen 2, not as much, but it's still, you know, but if you can find, you know, look, if you have the money to spend, get a 10 power. It'll still cost you, you know, like $1,500, but a 10 power would be great. And you can see, you know, that's about the highest power night vision binoculars I can find. I have yet to find any night vision binoculars with recording capability. I think that's a conspiracy in its own right. We're going to go to our second break here in just a minute, and just real quick, the score once again, I think right now is 160. Well, CNN.com is reporting 167-131 Trump. Although again, the West Coast hasn't closed. They close in about 5-10 minutes, and then, we'll see what happens. It's still going to be a horse race. Don't get me wrong, folks, just cause, Oh, yeah, here we go. Clinton wins Colorado and Virginia. Yeah, they're going to be going back and forth with this thing all night. So, in fact, it's 168, 131, 183, whatever. We'll just keep doing this for the next couple hours. Talk to you guys in a bit. You're on. Can you stay through the break?
Yeah, sure. Absolutely.
Okay, stay on through the break.
Okay.
This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network. We are TFR. Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, part 3 of 4, and tonight is November 8th, 2016. It is election night, and before we bring the caller on real quick, a quick announcement. Donald Trump has jumped out to a sizable lead. He's the first one to break 200, so he's 212 to Hillary Clinton's 131. And remember, first one to 270 wins, although the entire West Coast is going to go to Hillary, so she's going to catch up and hit 200, I would imagine, pretty quick. But Florida did go to Donald Trump. Interesting stuff. Again, who is it going to be tomorrow? You know, are we going to wake up to the jilted wife of an ex-president or a reality television star as president of the United States? Either way, it's surreal. But then again, I open with Flat Earth. Caller, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Oh, is this Mark?
How are you, sir? Yes, it is.
I'm good, man.
Hey, how come sharks don't bite lawyers?
I don't know.
Professional courtesy.
Nice.
Yeah, nice. I don't like lawyers either. Sorry.
No, lawyers are horrible. It's like, can you believe, by the way, it's 212, 131 right now.
Yeah, I'm sure that somehow she's still going to pull it out of her ass.
I'm sorry. The update already happened. So it's now, oh, yeah, here we go. Peanut Gallery, where are you getting your information? I'm covering all these multiple channels. It's 216 to 202 Trump right now. I knew that was going to happen. Yeah. So here we are. Now we're back in the horse race.
Yep.
I don't know why the websites are so slow to update this crap. There it goes. Finally, it updated. I don't even have to refresh it. They finally updated. So 202, yep, here we go. The West Coast is finally kicking in. Oregon's going to chime in here in a bit. And we still have some of the battleground states. But Florida, I knew, was going anyway. She was already two points ahead. Anyway, what's going on? Anything?
Not much. Just.
Did you actually go out and vote, by the way?
Yes.
All right.
I
you don't have to say
trying to avoid it. I'm sick of hearing about this already. It's like I'm on a thread with five friends, and they're like Little Women. They're just texting back and forth, and I'm like, give me a break.
Yeah.
We'll find out tomorrow. They're not going to decide tonight. Yeah. And who cares? Who cares?
I know. It doesn't make any damn difference as of tomorrow. The either way, they're both horrible choices. They're awful. I've never seen both. And I still think that, you know, if something happened to one of the candidates, you know, you still have some buffer zone here because technically neither of them get sworn in until January. So if something happened to one of them, then, you know, Obama could still be president.
When you were talking about that scenario before, it never even crossed my mind. And that's pretty darn scary because I don't know either one of these people's vice president or, you know, who they have running. They're running mate.
No, I looked at them again today. I looked at their full name and first name and last name, and I forgot them already. And that was only a few hours ago, and I've literally forgotten them already. It's like, damn, they're nobody. Just wallflowers. Why wouldn't Donald Trump pay for a heavy hitter? Why wouldn't Hillary Clinton use her influence and grab somebody that everybody knows? Why?
Right.
Why don't they do it? Right. So I still think it's a setup. I could be wrong. I've been wrong about other things. I know I'm not wrong about flat Earth, but I was wrong about Nibiru. Yeah. But then again, I wasn't you know a big player in the whole Nibiru thing.
Yeah, so. I don't know why that's coming around again.
That's never left. Nibiru has been kind of fluttering in the background for the last 4 years, and it will not go away. So.
I saw it in some of the kids' cartoons and crap he was watching. I'm like, they're talking about Nibiru? He goes, yeah, Dad, it's some other planet. I'm like, whoa. Programming.
Nice.
We talked about it, and he's like, well, that's weird. So nobody knows what the hell it is. And I'm like, no, of course not. It's just a story. Who knows? You know? I mean, I wonder if it's really what they were saying, that like a third transparent object that's the same size as the sun and moon.
Either way, I have a whole different take on it now, to where, you know, if you watch the movie with Kirsten Dunst a while back called Melancholia, you know, that was not a happy ending movie by any stretch. You know, Nibiru pretty much slammed, you know, one of the moons slammed into the Earth, and Earth was vaporized, basically. But
everybody dies.
Well, kind of like Knowing, you know, the end of Knowing, where everybody dies. Except for the children. But in this case, if Nibiru did start to show up in the sky, I would just laugh, and I'd say, okay, how exactly are they pulling this off? You know,
where's the projector?
What are they doing here? Where's the smoke and mirrors? Where's the misdirection? Because there's no way. I'd look in the sky and go, yeah, and news would be like, it's a whole other planet that we didn't see coming. I'm going, no, that's not it. You know, a lot of people would be like, you got to bow down to it. It's like, it's our new God. Anyway.
Oh, yeah. Horrible. And in my circle of friends, the UFO guys who I still talk to about some of this stuff, like I don't attack them with the flat Earth stuff. I just hit them with the NASA stuff because they all still think that that's real.
Yeah.
And they're like, well, maybe they fake some. And I'm like, no. It's all or nothing. I hate to say it, but it's all or nothing. It's so hard to discard everything you've learned and known all your life.
I know.
But
it's the aside. And if you watch, and I know it's easy for me to say because I've watched so many movies and I've seen so much media, and so I know plot lines as well as anybody. I probably could have been a writer at one point, for some sort of show. And that is, you don't. Oh, I lost my train of thought. where were you opening with on that one?
No, I forgot what I was saying.
The plot line here is that.
No.
You've got to lead in with something bigger than this. We've taken it as far as we can, and this story has to come to some sort of conclusion, one way or the other. The economy, the environment, the everything we've done from all the creative arts standpoints, we've taken it as far as we can, and we're ready, I think, for the next whatever it is. I mean, how much conditioning do you have to have? How many decades worth of science fiction movies do you have to throw at people before they open their minds to, you know, what's possible? what you were talking about, you know, that something that we, the conditioning has been so thorough, but I think that's where Flat Earth is, has really helped. And I've seen living proof of it where it's opened up people's minds to the point where like that no forests on Flat Earth thing really resonated, you know, and 2 years ago, it wouldn't have. 2 years ago, people would have said,
right.
You know,
right. I never would have considered even looking at it for a second.
Oh, yeah, me too.
And even this time, I was like, oh, geez, all right, let me listen to this. What the hell? I got some time.
Yeah.
And I listened to it and was like, oh, what if?
Yeah, I didn't shoot it down. I'm going, hey, it's not half bad. I mean, of course, it helped that I actually went to Devil's Tower. I was a big...
Yeah, I'd love to see that. I never knew the detail. I saw that, then I went and Googled it and started it. I never knew it was like that. I always thought it was scrapes, like it was...
Oh, yeah.
Out of the ground.
No. It's an interesting little thing, and I can see why Steven Spielberg's picked it. Great production value, and... it's an interesting, although odd. It's like, what is he doing in Wyoming? He must have seen this picture.
Yeah, well, it's just like anything else. Put it in our face, we accept it, and that's it. We move on.
Yeah.
Like I was thinking about that, like with the election and stuff, and it's almost. I hate to say it because you know they you hear about people in Iraq getting shot because they went to go vote, but it's almost like you shouldn't even vote because then whatever happens. Society is saying, okay, just go ahead, do whatever you want, putting people in there. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, and that whole, I think you were talking about it once with the guilt and stuff for consciousness that they have to put it out there, get the okay from everyone, and then go ahead.
Yep.
Crazy.
Yep.
Crazy.
Horrible. Hey, I do have to read a few more emails, man. Any parting shots before you go?
No, I was just, I'm just waiting for that movie Arrival. I want to.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm waiting for it too.
That story is about,
I like it.
I was watching, I watched that new Star Trek. It was hard to watch, but it's funny. Cause like you said, the programming is so better. It really is. It truly is.
Yeah.
I see it in everything. It's crazy. And what everyone listening should do with the information we have is take it back, take it in as, hey, we know the truth. Just go with the flow. You know, don't, there's too much stress.
Yep.
And I think that's what they feed off. Maybe, and maybe not like, like they say with the reptilians feed off the anger and hate. But I mean, I think that they really, like us, it was that heightened state of emotion because then we're malleable. They can tell us what to do, and people go, okay, I'll buy the new iPhone and worry about that more than what you guys are doing behind the scenes.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. All right.
Yeah. Totally.
All right,
agree, man.
I'll let you go.
All right, man. All right, have a good one. And as of you leaving right now, it is 2:22 to 2:02 from what I hear.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was shocked. I almost wasn't even going to listen to the show because you said you weren't going to do it. And I was like, I should just check for the hell of it.
Yeah, I got
that was awesome. I like it. I like it. It's like this secret special show.
Yeah, nice. Anyway, have a good one. See ya.
All right. Good night.
Bye-bye. All right. Guys, let's see here. Email from Theory. Theory? Theerry. Mark, you got to hang up your phone, by the way, or I'm going to cut you off.
Yeah, working on it. Sorry.
That's all right. I got him anyway. Couldn't hit his end button. Hey, Mark, first, I like your site and your video along with others. You have opened my mind to everything I didn't expect. Watching Part 11, Souls in the System, that's a Flat Earth Clues. I didn't understand why they would hide the truth, the dome, or something else if someone or something is watching. It just doesn't make sense. As you state in this video, if we knew that someone or something was watching, we would act like the astronauts. So why would they lie? Thanks again for your eye-opening work. Theory Gautier. That's Gautier. Hopefully I pronounced that right. Because you can't be the ultimate power. If I'm a government, you cannot intimidate people, and you cannot have ultimate control over the population unless you are the ultimate power. The same reason why, and other people have heard me say this, the same reason why the United States Air Force will not declare that they're UFOs, because if they don't control the skies, they don't control the skies. Anyway, real quick, Flat Earth News, and I know we're kind of doing election stuff and jumping all around. And by the way, check out, if you like this show, check out my subscription site, which is marksargent.com. If you don't like it, don't pay for it. But there's some really cool stuff on there that you won't find anywhere else. And of course, my book, Flat Earth Clues, which is on Amazon. When I do Flat Earth News, I just go into YouTube, I type in Earth is flat, and I set the filter to 1 week, and I see who's been doing what out there. Someone, of course, is making fun of the Earth is flat girl. She made that months ago, and she's still getting traction on that. Truth Documentary Channel is doing some fun stuff. Russian Vids, Antonio Subarets, Mark Sargent, I know that guy. Quasi-Luminous, he just keeps putting stuff out every freaking day. I don't know. That guy's got a lot of stamina. Globusters, The Power of Pyramids on Flat Earth, excellent. Let's see, the Morgiles putting out more stuff. Hey, it's Matt from the NASA channel. New ban on travel to Antarctica, 35 years, reaction to Flat Earth. Actually, some pretty good information in there. Check that out. Feed Your Mind, Quasi-Luminous. Free Chans doing more hangouts. I mean, I got to hand it to you guys. You're doing hangouts that are 8 hours long. I know you're not talking about Flat Earth most of the time, but the fact that you're doing hangouts 8 hours long and you just keep doing, I mean, I've seen stuff. I've been in little groups where I'm kind of monitoring from the outside. And it's like, hey, anyone got a chat tonight? It's turned into this weird party line, this Flat Earth chat party line, old school stuff. Let's see. Quasi-Luminous, NASA channel again, New World Order News, Mark Sargent. I'm still, by the way, if you don't see your email read here, chances are I will read it on a separate thing called Flat Earth Q&A emails. I've done 11 of them so far because the emails just won't stop. So I'll probably do 12, maybe this week, maybe not. I've got a thing tomorrow. We'll see. Let's see if there's anything else on the second page. I only go a couple pages here if I can. Let's go 3 pages just for the heck of it. Plano Existential, NASA channel. Man, he's cranking them out. Nathan Oakley, 1980. Snowwalker Prime. Let's see if anything else caught my... Oh, yeah, and Jaron did a great one. Jaronism. I know it's probably not on this list. He did a great one just very recently. I think it was yesterday, about scuba divers. Because, you know, they train the astronauts in deep... in underwater tanks. Big, giant swimming pools that they turn off the lights. And the footage is so good that, well, what's the difference between that and the real thing? And Jaron's pretty much saying there is no difference whatsoever. And he's got some neat takes on it. So check that out when you get a chance. Anyway, that was Flat Earth News. And the election results are still 222 to 202. Donald over Hillary. Remember, first one to 270 wins. And there's still a bunch of states out there that's still uncalled. You know, there's at least pushing a dozen that haven't been called yet. So we'll see how that turns out tomorrow morning. I am not staying up. We are not extending the show to figure that one out. Let's go to emails, shall we? Because we're still in part three. It's from James out of Australia. G'day, Mark. Thank you for your great work in uncovering. Really, you actually put g'day. So I thought it was a slang thing, g'day. You don't say good day. You actually put g-d-a-y. It doesn't matter. Thanks for your great work in uncovering the greatest deception. I believe your subject matter expert interviews are an extremely persuasive way to spread the Flat Earth good news. I've been wondering what I can do to spread the word. So I have begun sticking labels stamped with the words, the Earth is flat, Google it, on bus shelters, phone booths, and notice boards. Cheers, James from Southwest Australia. Thanks, James. That's an excellent idea. I recommend everybody just tag and graffiti the heck out of the world. And we'll get them to wake up eventually. This one's called Leap Seconds, sent by Game. Well, that's not his real name. Hello for another brain dropping of mine. Did anyone ever put his mind into leap seconds? They are inserted into the calendaric measurement of time every year. You can look that up on Wiki. This is to compensate for the claimed slowing down of the Earth's spin, twisting that it would seem to me as if the atomic clocks deviate every year for this much. Then they are adjusted to match the actual motion of the sun. Mighty is the creator. Secondly, did anyone ever offer globes of the USA, New York City, or maybe of North America? I guess I would love to get one for sure. I don't know what he's talking about there. Greetings and love from Matthias in Germany. Math writes, title of this email is called Moon Stuff, I think. Hey, Mark, I've seen most of your videos. I have noticed that in some of the shots taken by weather balloon cameras, you can clearly see the sun is closer than what they say. Almost to say, if the weather balloon was any closer, it would smack right into the sun. With that in mind, do you happen to know how close the sun and the moon actually are based on what evidence we do have? I actually think they're still a long way up, hundreds if not thousands of miles away. I don't think they're right up there. I know there's some videos showing them kind of in front of the clouds or behind the clouds, but I do think they're way up there because I don't think that we're that we would be allowed to smack objects into them. With that in mind, do you happen to know how close the sun are the sun and the moon within the firmament or outside? I don't think it really matters. I think they're either real close or, you know, just inside the firmament or just outside. I don't think it makes any difference. If the sun and the moon are within the firmament, do you think it could be very possible for us to actually land on the moon? No, I do not. The moon is only 30 miles wide. I don't think so. Not a chance. Living in Louisiana, I can see the moon appear very large in the sky. It seems to be inside the firmament. I just wonder if we could actually land on it, and especially if we're not whirling through space like they say we are. Anyway, I know you have lots to do, and I understand if you can't get to my email. I've just been thinking about this today. Thanks for exposing the truth. P.S. Also, you don't have to mention this if you read it on air, but have you heard of the people born into the group, a.k.a. the Illuminati? And this is from Caroline Hamlet. Oh, wait. If not, look them up. They're crazy, satanic, pedophile people running this world. Peace. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, whoever that Caroline Hamlet is, that's a person to look up. Anyway, that's from Matt Whittle, set designer, hairstylist, artist, and flat earther. Thanks, Matt. Roy writes, canary bird. If you have a bird flying inside an airplane, will the airplane have the same weight in the air? Roy, I don't know the answer to that question, Roy, and that's a really weird question. So I have no idea, nor how would you even measure it? Don't know. That's a great little riddle, though. Send it to somebody at a university and let them crank on that for a while. There's no way to prove that the weight of the airplane. Anyway, I had to read that one because it was just weird. Struck me as odd. This one's from JFAT. First off, I would like to apologize for my silly and redundant queries. I watched the Under the Dome documentary about 8 or 9 times. Oh, Lord, that's pretty much my Flat Earth clue, is he watched 8 or 9 times and was stunned. I related to the narrative as the narrator. You? Yes, it was me. Is a conspiracy theorist. I believe that this world of ours has had countless untold civilizations on it throughout, and the small bits and pieces that are found, like the Klaus Dona, are a tantalizing peek at... just actually nice to ponder. I honestly never put two and two together to see how much my thoughts mesh with your narrative. I kind of focused on a bit at the end when the reset thing was mentioned casually, yet very strongly. I apologize for being a horrible emailer. Actually, you're not the worst I've ever seen, believe it or not. I can't express my questions in an email. Yeah, you're doing okay. If you could ever give me 5 or so minutes, I have questions about this theory, and I'm just better at vis-a-vis or at least noticing my thoughts than writing. I know you undoubtedly have a trillion people battling for your time. Well, no, because there's only 7 billion people in the world. My name is Jesse Cazarez, and my number is, insert number here, I am available almost 24/7 as I am an insomniac and work for myself. Well, at least you're honest. Please don't write me off as a kook or nut job. I am very sincere in my efforts and try to make sense of the secrets of our history. Yours, JJ Fat. And yeah, no, I'm not going to write you off because, hey, man, you know, I open my mornings with a big breakfast bowl of flat earth. So there's not much really anybody can say to me that is going to shock my sensibilities at all, ever. I don't think, anyway. Oh, let's see here. This one's by a Southern... Oh, this one's from Larry. Thanks for all of your... This is for all your round-earther astrophysicist wannabes. If this ACW-130 can feel the wind as it flies through a hurricane, why can't it feel the atmosphere going 1,000 miles an hour at the equator as it flies to the east? I can't wait to hear these statements. or hashtag flat earth. I just sent this across social media, Larry. And that's awesome. That's awesome. I think I got to save that photo. Cool. Thank you very much, man. I'm gonna don't want to delete that one. I got a couple minutes to the break. I think I can crank out a few more. This one's called They Are Even Telling You. Hey, these are very, very serious messages they are giving us. Watch these. Like I said before, I think they are going to see stuff go down really fast here, but where to run? I'm sure it's about the end of the world. You know what? Let's one day at a time. We got to get through the election first, but thank you, David. This one's from Flat Bastard. This one's called, Hey Mark, you and Matt Boylan ruined my life about a year and a half ago. That's a great opening line. I love that line. I have an interesting take on the ISS from a welder's perspective. The expert on valves and seals was absolutely correct when he mentioned that the ISS would need a machine shop on board. Being that the ISS is made of metal, you would absolutely need welders on board, but you wouldn't be able to power them up there. I doubt they would have access to 220-volt receptacles. Let's just say they do. Why don't we ever see astronauts welding when they are outside? Good point. Sparks should constantly be flying up there. But wait, sparks around or inside a spaceship might not be the smartest idea. The whole idea is impossible. You would need several maintenance men working 24/7, which we never see. Anyways, thanks for ruining my life. I wouldn't have it any other way. That's from Flat Bastard. I was thinking of Jake Bastard. Flat Bastard. Awesome. Thanks, man, from welder's point of view. Super great. Oh, let's see. And the update of the election. Before we go to break here, because it is election night, it is November 8th. It is Trump wins Utah, and so it's 222... Oh, no, it's still 222-209. No big surprise there. Hillary got Oregon. And there's still, a dozen states? 10 states left, I think. Somebody should count those up. And, yeah, with 10 states left, it's still anybody's game. First one to 270 wins it. So we're going to go to break here in a bit, and then we're going to go into Section 4. And anyone wants to call in, that phone number is 720-897-6111. That phone number is 720-897-6111. You know what? I don't want to do anything before we go to break. I should, suppose I do a quick shout out to my good friend Melody out in Canada, if she's listening right now, unless she's sleeping. It's early, though. Why are you sleeping? She'll be listening to the show. Anyway. When we come back, we'll read some more emails, we'll take some more calls, and do not expect this election to be over. I don't think it's going to be wrapped up in the next 30 minutes. Battleground states are just too close to call. So who are we going to get? Who's it going to be tomorrow, huh? It seems to me so strange. Stay tuned.
We are TFR.
My faith in destiny is all I need to prevail.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, part 4 of 4. Is your last chance to call in on this historic election night, November 8th, 2016. Phone number to call in is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. And of course, if you want to email into the show and want me to read your email on air from the safety of your living room, that email address is msargent23@comcast.net. I have had that email for 20-something years. So, oh yeah, and by the way, that was Joe Jackson stepping out from his album, Everyone Together Now, Night and Day. And yeah, I know it's the election. Everybody's saying, oh yeah, it could go this way and that, and it really depends what website you go to. It's like NBCnews.com, which is, you know, heavy Democratic leanings. They delayed, and now they're saying 228-209 to Trump. And Fox, they announced that way earlier, and then CNN, they're just kind of dragging their feet as well, because they usually go with the incumbent president, although Fox goes heavy Republican. So we'll see. As fact, yeah, CNN's going 197-187. Yeah, that's because they want more theater out of this. You know, does Trump have the momentum? I don't know. I'm looking at 1-2. Let's see, Nevada. I don't want to dwell on this too much. Okay, still in play. We got, I believe that's Georgia, Nevada, Arizona, Alaska, and I'm doing this, the names aren't on these states, Michigan, Wisconsin, Minnesota, Maine, God, what's that one up there? Is that New Hampshire or Rhode Island? I think that's Rhode Island, way up there in the corner in the east. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10 states at least. So we'll see. New Hampshire. Thank you, Peanut Gallery. All right, let's get back to the emails. And if you guys want to call, by all means, you know, I'm up for it. I'm feeling froggy. This one's from Gail. Gail writes, and she's up in 12 states. Thank you, Peanut Gallery. Mark, you have become the pragmatic and sensible gateway for the modern Earth and space revelations, which were germinated and stoked about 2 years ago. You have abetted a spectacular deprogramming effort that is best described as exciting and hopeful. Your Clues video package remains the touchstone for any successful entry-level foray into this type of discussion. To that, I came upon an absolutely stellar, pun intended, set of videos by a gentleman named Southern Israelite. It is a 12-part series that touches on the many logical fallacies employed by the scientific community on this subject, as well as very specific historical recapitulations and spectacular line-item objective analysis pertaining the lion's share of issues involved in understanding these modern Earth and space revelations. If you have not already viewed this video package, I highly recommend them that you set aside a couple of hours one night and do so. I've literally viewed and listened to thousands of videos on this subject since June of 2015, and I can safely state that this video package is easily in the top 10 presentations regarding these subjects. Be well. Best regards. Gail Northcutt of Baldwin, Maine. And the phone number to call in, of course, for the last part of the show. I know it's getting late for you guys on the East Coast and those of you calling from the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, somewhere in the Bermuda Triangle. It is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. Hans writes, seriously, his name's Hans. Hans Stom. That's a great name. Hi, Mark. I just saw a map. Again, I'm reading it as is. Just saw a map showing more landmass than this Earth together, which is apparently ancient. Not a clue how this map was made or if it's for real. But anyhow, I noticed something in Admiral Byrd's observation. Great Lakes, which are a few degrees above freezing point, approximately 3.3 degrees Celsius. Hey, look, dude, I'm in the United States. We don't use that Celsius crap. Thinking this through, how come it's behind the Great Wall where it's freezing? Who said it's behind the Great Wall where it's freezing? Meaning, is it freezing behind the Great Wall? Few options. Heat coming from below or above to meet the ice, melt ice. From below would be easily accepted. What if it's from above where it's heated with another sun or multiple suns? Anyway, I feel trapped now by this fence, which is why I mentioned it in the clues. People don't like being fenced in. Also makes me wonder, if Antarctica is the Great Wall, then it's the biggest wall we know of so far, which should have many leaks or unguarded areas for us to break through. You'd think so. There might even be another wall surrounding the unknown land masses. Who knows? What is a thing to hold us back is that there is no plant life, according to Byrd, but he did really see everything. Not possible. Might even be that on his last expedition he found plant life in abundance and even possibly animals. Does it become warmer again the further out you go? That's a good question. Anyway, there's a lot of coverage on the net about the flat Earth, proving and disproving. I wish more would focus on the reasons we were kept here to demand true knowledge, the freedom to go see without danger of being shot. Also, in the Bible, there is a mentioning of a new earth and a new heaven. the firmament. Most think that it's spiritual, but if this is not strange enough already, we might even have new bodies, as mentioned, and inhabit a physical place. Anyway, there is good reason to not let us know, but who knows, some elite will just dump this earth and move out over the wall, out of reach for anyone, leaving us in agony as their slaves. Too many questions, but there are lots who don't doubt the flat earth. I, for one, would like to know more about what's next and how. The wall is too big to be guarded properly. Why can't we sneak out? Hans. Aw, Hans. That's nice. You go ahead and try to book something to try to sneak out. The thing about sneaking is you got to be sneaky. And if you're going to be using, you know, commercial boats to go to a continent where nobody goes to, you're going to be noticed by somebody. I'm just saying. Oh, let's see. Dennis writes... whatever, it's Dennis, right? Hi, Mark. I know that you've been receiving tons of emails, but I still hope to have your feedback on this. I'm resending this email I sent before. And I don't want to read this one. It's too scattered at the moment. Sorry. And that one was from an interview I did, if I'm not mistaken. I just did one for Mysterious Radio today. That was Flat Earth Clues interview number 91. So hopefully I'll be posting that soon. So check that out when you get a chance. It actually went pretty well. This one's from David. He goes, hello, Mr. Sargent. I came across an interesting post yesterday or today on Instagram, and it led me to your YouTube videos on Instagram, really. And I find everything that you talk about very interesting. I find it absolutely fascinating, intriguing, and very realistic. The reason I find it so realistic is by the way things are positioned in everyday life. A plate on a table, a disc being thrown, etc. I'm sorry, etc. Gotta get that one. However, I would love to hear all that you would have to discuss on this topic. But the one thing that still makes me wonder is then how is the theory of the sun and how the earth travels on an elliptical path, creating both day and night as well as the seasons. How does that fit or become in the flat earth model? We'll get to that in a second. I really hope to hear from you soon. I would like for you to know that I am a believer in God the Almighty and have always been and will always be. Though I was a mathematics major in the College of Science at the University of Arizona, what I found very odd is that everyone knew that I had such great ideas, plans, and major models of improvement of our society, my city in which I live, but no one would assist me in making these things happen. Though they were relatively reasonable to attain and would contribute to a major positive change in our universe, maybe this may lead to some clue as to why. Would my theories prove things to be correct or incorrect in certain areas that would change the value of our everyday life, or would they create new doors by which we would explore? I have not been able to answer that question. Anyway, I would really appreciate an explanation on how the travel path of our seasons and the sun take in the flat earth model. Thanks for your consideration for my simple request with and in all sincerity, Mr. David C. Garza. And yeah, David, here's the thing, especially if you're a big believer in God, you want to see a neat model, go to Rob Skiba's webpage, which is testingtheglobe.com, and he's got some great animations, some great time-lapse stuff that covers an entire calendar year, if I'm not mistaken, or multiple years, and shows how the sun and the moon travel in the sky. A picture is worth 1,000 words, and I think that would help you a great deal. So we still got 17 minutes. Let's take a quick look at the election, because Lord knows we got to check that out. So let's go to foxnews.com, because as you know, they are the world's news leader. Foxnews.com says Trump wins Wisconsin, battleground, and Iowa, battleground states. All right, so it's coming down to the wire here. 254 to 209. Donald Trump needs 16 electoral votes to win. Hillary needs 61. Holy smokes. Could this actually happen? Or are they going to turn this into a horse race? You know, there's still a few states left. Hillary, you know, it's still anybody's game. Will Donald Trump get one more state and then they'll call it at that point? Oh, who knew? Here and there, I'm saying that sucker would not be over tonight. And it might. Will it be over in the next 20 minutes? Let's find out. I'm not going to just sit here and stare at the page. I'm going to keep reading your emails, but I will have this thing, you know, in the background. So here we go. Lewis writes, All right. You've got me thinking now. Great videos. I don't know if you covered it, but how about the depth of our oceans and how do we get our jet streams and ocean currents if the Earth is flat and isn't spinning? It's not very hard. You know, it's just flat and they still travel in a big circle. It's not, you know, the underwater conveyor system. In fact, if you view the underwater conveyor system in an AE map, an azimuthal equidistant map, it looks, you know, even more efficient in my opinion. Also, if your theory is right, what about biblical stories and or prophecies that can be explained with this flat earth theory alongside, let's say, dimensions? Supposedly, there's what I believe. I may be wrong. Do you believe you go to other dimensions once you get past Antarctica? I mean, wow, man. I've been up 2 days just searching this stuff up. 2 days, that's nothing. I know people that haven't slept for weeks on this. So, what was this question? Oh, yeah, the biblical stories. Yeah, definitely check those out. Go to testingtheglobe.com. There's some wonderful stories. The Tower of Babel, probably the most prominent. Joshua, and a whole bunch of Bible verses on top of that. 502 area code calling in. Let's pick them up. You're on live with Strange World.
Hey, Mark, how you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I am doing awesome.
Cool. So go ahead and make the prediction.
Nope, that's not what I called for.
That's not what you called for on election night with Trump within a golf shot of winning this thing?
Oh, you can't predict that stuff. You know, they could change it. They'll do their little... I think they'll announce him as a winner first.
Yeah, but will it be close enough for her to demand a recount or not?
I don't know. I don't know who you watch. Fox has got him way ahead, but CNN's still got Clinton ahead.
I swear. Well, yeah, and that makes sense, again, because of those three networks. CNN goes with whoever's president, you know, so they're leaning Democratic. They used to lean Republican. NBC News is severely Democratic, and Fox News, let's face it, Fox News was created for the sole purpose of countering NBC News. That's the only reason they even exist. Nobody's got the Republicans back. We've got to create an entire news division just to put the Republican spin on it. So, but no, isn't this kind of spooky though? You know, will Fox call it before CNN calls it?
We'll find out shortly, probably, at the rate they're going.
I know.
But because... that's not what I called.
Oh, okay. Well, what's up?
I actually called about a flat earth thing.
You did not.
I did too.
Okay.
And not got? Satellites.
Oh,
no, so I was talking to my 9-year-olds about the atmosphere and everything else. And they brought up an interesting question. So gravity holds all the air down, right?
Yeah.
But space is a vacuum. But my kids can pick up the vacuum cleaner and suck air up down here this low.
Yes.
So why doesn't the air go out, get sucked out to space?
Yeah. Well, no, that's an excellent question. And you're not the first one to mention it, but it's very, very valid, which is, if the atmosphere, which is this light, fluffy thing, is being held by gravity, but the vacuum of space, which is amazingly powerful, or, you know, any vacuum. I mean, it doesn't have to be space. We, you know, we can create vacuum chambers now, and you can do amazing things with the power of vacuum. Take any submarine, for example. What's holding, you know, are we talking a water tension scenario where, and if something punched through it, you know, wouldn't it kind of weaken that part, and wouldn't the air kind of rush out if that was the case? If you were really, you know, if there was that much, basically, where's the field integrity on the atmosphere? You can have field integrity if it's an enclosed system, but if it's just an open, if it's an open thing, holy smokes, they already announced the winner.
Not that I know of. I don't know if they're commercial.
I've got somebody messaging me right now going, like he's jumping up and down. I'm going, really? Because CNN is still got 216 to 209. You know, they're turning it, you know, that's strictly ratings, turning it into a horse race. But Fox News is what? They're already declaring it?
No, I don't think so. Because they're on commercial. They would declare, they wouldn't be on commercial if they did that.
No, they wouldn't. Anyway, but yeah, you're absolutely right. The power of vacuum is extremely strong. So what is holding the atmosphere? And if some people say, well, that's just a simple thing. Scientists, I don't think, really have the answer. They say the answer is always gravity. And
yep, that's their answer. And like I said, my 9-year-old stumped me because, like, well, no, you got a point. I don't know.
I mean, find at lower levels, fine. If you want to talk about, like, the ocean, you know, you get super dense water, you know, water compresses
right.
a little bit when you get at super depth deep levels. But that means at the surface, the water is lighter, which means in the atmosphere, it's way worse. You know, we're talking about thin atmosphere when you get up there, right? Mm-hmm. So, what's keeping the vacuum of space from just ripping off that air? And we've always assumed that it just doesn't. Nobody's got an answer. They go, well, it doesn't, obviously. Otherwise, it would have. That's the answer.
Well, the point that you just mentioned is partially wrong, is water cannot be compressed. You can't compress liquid, but you compress air.
Well, yeah, but even they've shown that in certain – and it's tough to test, of course. In super deep water scenarios, if you're talking about really, really cold water, it has something
high
to do with
pressure. Not
yeah,
compressed water. It's just the weight of the water above you.
Yeah, but there's, what do they call it? I'd have to look it up. I know you can't, yeah, we can't compress water here, but I think in extreme, you're right. For all intents and purposes, you can't compress water really much at all to any degree. But from what I understand, at super deep, with enough pressure, you can compress it a little bit, but not, you know, not like anything else, I guess. No. That's just what I heard. Anyway, but you're absolutely right. The vacuum should counteract it. Absolutely should. And I think it's something we have taken for granted because, well, if we're still breathing, that's the logic I think everybody uses. If you're still breathing, then obviously it doesn't. And it's like, well, yeah, but why doesn't it? You know, and it's like, well, it doesn't if it's enclosed. If you're in a big room, there's nowhere for the air to go. But no one would ever think about that. Anyway.
Well, it's like I always say, science doesn't lie, scientists do.
Yeah.
But scientists have all their explanations for all the little pieces, that makes sense. But when you start putting all the pieces together, the puzzle doesn't match.
Yeah.
It just falls apart. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I agree. You know, what was the line? I think it was Tesla that said it. I'm going to look up NBC News real quick. Now you guys are going to hear me typing. It's going to sound really loud. But the Tesla said something to the effect of that science, you know, just keeps working. I think it was him that said it, that they just keep building, you know, once the first equation is laid down like a foundation, they just keep building on top of that equation. Nobody keeps checking the original equation to make sure that was right to begin with. They assume that it was right. And he goes, by the time you get, you know, to a certain level, it's just a bunch of numbers that mean nothing. You know, it's just a string of formulas that were built on crap to begin with, which was been my argument for a while now. Well, you know, they say, well, are you smarter than Bill Gates? And you're smarter than Einstein and Bill Gates. Oh, my God. Einstein and Stephen Hawking. Why did I compare Stephen Hawking to Bill Gates? They do look kind of similar in a way. But I go, no, I don't have to be smarter because, yeah, they were really, really smart, you know, heavy math guys. But if the foundations that they were working on, if their textbooks that they were working on as their basis were wrong, then the whole thing's wrong. The whole thing's now NBC News, by the way, they are ahead of CNN. They're going 244 to 209. So even they are dragging, holy smokes. And they just announced did you already have Georgia, Trump winning Georgia? And yeah, Tom Brokaw
has him at 254 for Trump.
Okay. Tom Brokaw already said that whoever wins, the other side is going to contest it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It'll be funny because it'll be funny about it since we're back in the election. It'll be Clinton contesting it after they slammed Trump for saying he would.
Yeah.
But it's just like at the beginning of the Republican thing when they asked, you know, all the candidates, will they support whoever's elected? Trump didn't raise his hand at first.
Yeah.
But now all those other people jumped off, whatever.
Yeah.
It's a great drama. Hey, one more thing real quick.
Yeah.
For everybody. National Geographic TV is airing a new series starting the 14th.
Oh, is this the one where all those celebs are in it?
No. This is a Mission to Mars.
I've heard about this. Elon Musk makes an appearance.
I want to see how well they do with all the weightless, it's them on the ship and everything else.
Yeah.
See how well they do compared to ISS footage and whatnot.
You can't, you still can't do it. You cannot do it. I wasn't kidding.
I got you. I agree, but I want to see how they do it.
There's nothing. There's, you would have to film the entire thing ahead of time, and you would have to run it through so many editors and focus groups, secret focus groups, military focus groups, that because one mistake and it's over.
Yep, but they're airing this on the 14th, so it'll be interesting to watch.
Yeah.
If it's a prep to get ready for it. One more thing for you.
Yeah.
I got to know.
What?
Are you going to go watch a Star Wars movie next month?
I didn't watch the last one until it came out on Netflix.
Oh, so. You're a disgrace to your generation.
I watched I was in the theater for Star Wars Empire Strikes Back, Return of the Jedi, you know, sat through the Ewoks. I went to the theater for the next three, you know, waited all those years, went to the theater, you know, angry when the Jar Jar, you know, when the first one came out and Jar Jar was there, so unbelievably angry that he came up with that character. And here's the reason why, and I'll wrap this up real quick for you, which is there was that part in the where Jar Jar, you know, the big Jar Jar episode where he got zapped, you know, his head got zapped and he did the whole I have a numb tongue thing. And I was a big fan of old school comedy, stand up comedy. So, you know, I knew Steve Martin and, Bill Cosby and Richard Pryor. And he ripped off the Bill Cosby dentist sketch for that.
Yes, he did.
For that scene. And I'm looking around, I was going, nobody else has seen this. I mean, it was a packed theater. We had to wait in the parking lot for hours. Packed theater. And I'm going, nobody else knows this is the Bill Cosby dentist sketch. And he put that in there because George Lucas, that would be about his time frame. I was going, oh. Yep. And it's not even that good a sketch. It's good,
no,
but anyway.
It's still a ripoff.
It's still a ripoff.
Hey, real quick. So speaking of that, the episode, the stupid episode one show, that movie that came out.
Yeah.
I saw that in Kosovo.
Really?
And while I was watching that in Kosovo, our artillery started firing out. Great special effects.
Nice. Nice. That's awesome. That's awesome.
All right. I'm going to get back to your show.
All right, man. Thank you.
All right. Have a good one.
Bye. Okay, can we do one more email before we go? Yeah, sure. Let's do this one. This one is from Bresis, Bresseis. I do not know how to pronounce that. I consider myself somewhat of a conspiracy theorist, maybe not as hardcore as some, but I definitely believe there is so much out there that cannot be explained. So I have heard of the Flat Earth theory before. I have never paid any attention to it. I laughed it off and thought that anyone who believed it was ridiculous. Granted, I never spent any time actually reading into it. So recently, again, that's the only way you can avoid it. You don't look at Pandora's box. You can make fun of Pandora's box. Don't open it, though. It'll get you. So recently, someone close to me had watched your documentary and was completely enthralled in the idea of it, became a complete believer. After pestering me about it, I finally relented and watched the video. I came in with so many questions and was so ready to argue why it was wrong. Halfway through, I completely changed my mind. I just wanted to thank you for how well compiled and thorough your video was. So thank you for opening my eyes. Aw, that's nice. And so positive. That's great. I mean, I hardly get any hate emails anyway. If you guys want to email me and want me to read it on the air, it's msargent23@comcast.net. We got less than 2 minutes till the end of the show. Let's see. John Kerry. Oh, yeah, I got to mention that real quick, and we probably already talked about it. I got to say it, and that was during this election night, who went to Antarctica? Secretary of State John Kerry. Why was he in Antarctica on election day? Really, really strange, and you can look it up on YouTube, and in fact, he had a press conference on it, and quite a few people talked about it, so it was interesting. Yeah, that's it. So let's do one more little election thing. We're just going to look at NBC News because they're heavily Democratic. And right now they've got Hillary losing 244 to 209. First one to 270 wins. But it sounds like whoever wins, the loser is going to contest it. So you know, don't expect this thing to be over. I still thought, you know, it wouldn't get to 270 by tonight. Maybe it will. Maybe it won't. I don't know. We'll see. Quick shout outs, of course. One is to Melody out in Canada. Hope you're doing well. And next shout out, of course, to everybody in the Flat Earth community. Keep doing what you're doing. Try to stay positive. try not to get on karma's bad side. Don't be like Lee Bracker. Don't do it. Ten Commandments. I still don't remember all of them by heart, but I do try to tell people one thing, and that is treat others better than you treat yourself. If you do that, the world will be a better place. Check out the free site, enclosedworld.com, marksargent.com is the subscription site. The book, Flat Earth Clues, is on amazon.com, including the audiobook, or just type in Flat Earth Clues into any search engine, and you'll find just a treasure trove of everything. So, see you guys next time, okay?